Of course, all of there was many, there were many talks if that Asian should be recognized as a disease. Some people are against this and so on. But it has a lot of practical implications because I know at least two cases when biomedical companies could not register anti-aging compounds as anti-aging. They had to register it for some specific organ. That means that they were much less efficient in working with investors. So basically now it didn't really go to clinical practice. So if we talk about legal background, so please remember that we all have right to health. By all countries of people which are here, they are parties to the World Health Organization. And the Constitution of the World Health Organization is a legally binding document. So it says that governments have responsibility for the health of their people, which can be fulfilled only by the provision of adequate health and social measures. That means that governments are mandated to give you all possible treatments. Of course, if you live in Nigeria, you maybe will be they mandated to give you antibiotics and vaccination. If you live in a high-income countries, they are mandated to give you a knee implant, but it's their responsibility. It's not that something begging from them. Recently there was adoption of United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, and all countries signed up to this. That means that now they are obliged. And one of the goals is to reduction of one-third of mortality from non-communicable diseases. They're mostly Asian-related diseases. So, we have been working quite a lot on lobbying WHO. A lot of course has to be done. We promoted, you recognize here Mr. Anisimov maybe, a champion on metformin studies and melatonin studies. So we came there and with the big help of the International Longevity Alliance of people who were there, who were working and advocating online, we managed to push the entire new chapter into the Global Strategy and Action Plan on Aging Your Health on innovation, on research and innovation. And with the help of other people, for example, and Elena and Eduard and Ilya Stamper were quite helpful, fulfillment of the strategy is included into the World Health Organization goals for the Medicaid. So we're quite not new people and working in WHO. So is aging a disease or not disease? What is disease? Disease, my friends, is a word. And it can be defined differently. We will never even going to have united a definition, because this word is defined in different laws of different countries. Here I show you two examples, one from US law, another one from Russian law. They are different. And that means that disease is what is written in the law. Basically there will not be single definitions. And to my opinion, aging fits more or less these definitions. But there was a process of developing new revision of international classification of diseases. Why it is important for us? Because in most countries, it is integrated into legislation that to register a new therapy, it should be against a disease. It is done differently, but generally it is the case in most countries. So in the previous version, there was a code F54, senility. Some people thought it was a garbage code, but Russian gerontologists managed to develop clinical practice guidance to address frailty based on that code, so it was not right, but it's anyway gone. Fortunately, World Health Organization proposed in 2011 criteria of the diseases for the purpose of this particular process, revision of the ICD from 10 to 11. So it says the disease, there should be clinical and reproducible description. There should be they should have signs and symptoms. You should have causal agents, which means molecules which cause this disease somehow, or pathogens, causal mechanisms, interventions. Also, they require actually some information, like additional information on genetics, relationship to genetics, if there is some relationship to environment, and so on. So we decided to go through this list to see if it fits through or not. First of all, the hardest part was pathological mechanisms, because of course you know they're very complex, but it's not the case only for aging, but also of course for many diseases, like for Alzheimer's, for example, but it's still recognized as a disease. What we did quite systematic literature search, not in a structural, but quite extensive, to see how different organs age and what, according to modern clinical literature, causes this. And also we documented interventions. We developed huge database in some special software just to keep it all in mind. So basically, of course, if we see that this is aging has some specific pathological processes, as we call it, the genetic processing, which are interrelated, but they're not numerous. Of course, we did not put everything which causes as aging. Sometimes we had to merge some categories, like protein studies failure, for example. Sometimes there is just not good enough human data, and if you write to WHO, something about worms and mice, they will not really take it seriously. We only took human clinical data. But in any way, the complexity is not eternal. It is manageable. Basically, we think we established these mechanisms. We found that there are biomarkers of aging, including frailty index. Frailty indexes, there are many of them, but still they are already used as endpoints in clinical trials registered with the FDA and so on. For example, do statins improve or not frailty index? So there are clinical trials on that already. So with diagnostics, we have no problem. Then interventions. So while we were doing this literature search, we found a number of interventions which address one or more pathological processes of aging. I'm not sure that you could really see it, but it is on the poster, at least the top ones. So we also try to check if it, according to known meta-reviews, meta-analysis of clinical studies, if it reduces all-cause mortality, mortality from cancer and cardiovascular mortality. This is the last table. All-cause mortality, and before this cancer mortality, and then cardiovascular mortality. So we found quite a lot of interventions which are already available for people, which slow down pathological process of aging, and many of them are known to reduce mortality, sometimes in general population, sometimes a specific group of patients. So this is the second part of this table. There are some pieces were funny, unexpected ones. Some pieces are quite known. For some suspected genoprotectors, we didn't find any evidence of really effectiveness. But this completely, it's not from mice, this information comes from humans. Of course, you know that there are some genetic correlations with aging, not very many, but still. There are, of course, environmental influence on aging. For example, smoking is a typical example. If you want to die or age early and die earlier, you need to smoke for this. So we put it all up and submitted it through online form to the WHO, not even from a country, because when we came for the strategy on aging, I and my colleagues came as a delegation of the country. Here we just submitted it online, and I'm not even a medical doctor, although Yuri as a medical doctor and Uncle Evita, and we have also biologists, but still. So to our own surprise, WHO reacted. They said that they are going to partially implement it and please provide a definition of aging. Like very, very quickly, urgently, we were afraid to lose this. We wrote down some definition of aging. After we developed perhaps a better one, but still the old one is hanging there in the old organization system. And what they did not make a big code aging, unfortunately, we don't know yet. Maybe ideologically it would be better, but what they proposed to introduce extension code. Extension code aging related, which could be added to any other pathologies which are already there. And then you get combined code, this is typical internal NICD, and you get kind of new diseases. So this is their message to us. Could you please provide a definition of aging related? And for that we needed a definition on aging. Opry was helping us with the definition, and so on. So, for example, there is already acquired immune deficiency in ICD-11, which was actually adopted this October. It was fixed now. So if you had aging related immune deficiency, you can get quite specific pathological process of immune senescence, of exhaustion of T cells. And now it's possible, we believe, to register therapies. Or, for example, aging related amyloidosis of cardiac sinus. It's a very common, really, cause of death in older people, leading to heart diseases and mortality, cardiovascular mortality. So now it's possible, we believe so, to develop therapies against such conditions. And not only curable therapies, but also preventive therapies. Which means it is possible to register something which prevents immune deficiency or amyloidosis or lung atrophy. There is no anymore legal barriers to that. So right now we just need to estimate and kind of model, kind of promote response in consequences in health care systems. As plus, you remember what I told about human right to health? Doctors in general, they prescribe to patients certain drugs, not because they want to, because they have to. They're obliged to do all their necessary interventions to prevent diseases and treat diseases, including aging-related diseases. And of course, they need to see what is feasible. Because, like, for example, cancer therapies can be very expensive. In some countries, you don't get it from the governments, governmentally sponsored medical organizations, best cancer treatments. And sometimes doctors do not even advise. They really kind of break you. It's not really legal, but still that happens. It's a very tricky balance between what is possible and what is necessary. For example, in developed at least countries, and in developing too, doctors, they must prescribe vaccination against pneumonia to everybody who is older than 60. That still doesn't happen to every person who is older than 60, because it is necessary still to promote it with GPs. So Pfizer, for example, they developed AstraZeneca, such vaccines against pneumococcus, and they promote it. They tell geriatricians, they tell GPs that you have to do it, and they really, doctors really have to do it. So imagine that there would be an affordable, effective, and safe therapy against immune senescence then all doctors will be mandated to prescribe it. If it's for curing it, and you know, maybe some cells, then to people after 60 years old. If it's to prevent it, to people before 60 years old. So, and we think that this is a very good incentive for investment because, of course, you know, the market is huge, and now it's possible to do something in terms of registering anti-aging therapies. What do you think needs to be done? It's actually a good question, so we're welcoming your ideas. I think we need to promote medical work with medical communities, GPs, gerontologists, to first the improve popularity of the preventive anti-aging therapies and to push it to clinical practice guidelines. They already prescribe it. For example, aspirin is widely prescribed. And this is a like normal, typical anti-aging therapy, because it's done for primary prevention. But that they just kind of need to accept it more that what they're doing is anti-aging therapy. Or they were talking about healthy lifestyle. It is being prescribed for prevention, primary prevention, and so on by doctors. So we need to spread information about new legal framework and opportunities, just to tell people that now it's possible. To tell investors, now you can invest into that. We need maybe to develop as an idea international classification of aging-related pathologies. That helps sometimes to push it into ICD and so on. A lot of medical communities done it. Like for example, there is a classification of mental diseases or pain-related diseases and so on. I think we can already initiate clinical trials on anti-aging therapies, and the first pioneers we need to support them to establish the procedures because it will be new to regulators, new to drug developers, and so on. And of course, when it's available, and maybe for already available treatments, we need to lobby reimbursements from whatever reimburses. This sometimes it's government, sometimes it's medical insurance company, and so on. So with this, we would like to thank you and thank SciHub Project and Alexandra Elbakan, which is helping to fulfill a right to access to scientific literature worldwide, and to welcome your ideas and collaboration.
Thank you very much.